Welcome everybody. My name is, it's our topic, Building Complex QML GUIs with Qt Quick 2. I think it's right spelled. So my name is Morten Lang. I'm currently in my second year of my apprenticeship as IT specialist application development by IPOBLAN. You see the logo of our company on the left above. So, and Dennis Effmert, he's my mentor. He will continue the presentation afterwards. So, if you have questions, please remember them and ask them at the end of the presentation. And we also have a stand outside this room. When you have detailed questions, we can ask there. You can ask them there. So, I hope everybody is fine and well saturated that we can start with the first chart, the table of contents. First, I will start with an introduction to our company, IPOBLAN, and also the software and hardware we made and we develop and made. Then, we will shortly raise the data model concept. So we are now going to one of our products, that's IPOLOG, and IPOLOG is a 4D simulation software. It's for the fabric factory planning, and there we have three views we will go on. It's the worker guns, the material zone editor, and the rack planogram. After that, Dennis will make a live implementation. So let's start with the introduction. We have two locations of our company. It's the headquarters is in Leonberg. It's near Stuttgart. There is the service located, and in Ulm, that's between Stuttgart and Munich, there's our research and development department. We have approximately about 60 employees. In Ulm, about 10 developers, and the others in Leonberg. We have software developers, engineers, and a wide range of persons who work with us. We are the products we made or we develop and on. We also use in Leonberg. That means we support our own software. And our main customers are Daimler, Siemens, Eisenmann, Liebherr. The most consumers are in the automotive sector. Yeah, here we see our software products made by IPOBLAN. On the left side, we have our Poly software we developed and we are developing. And on the right side, the software and hardware. We will start on the left side with IPOLOG, I already said. That's the 4D simulation software for factory planning and process optimization. And with this planning tool, we can visualize two features we integrated with virtual reality simulation and also CRD. That's why you have a wide range of options to plan and implement your factory needs. Very detailed efficiency and also reliability. The advantage is very easy, and on the hand you have in one program everything you need in a transparent way. You can see in one program everything, all information you need. The software had also been honored on the Logimat 2013. Logimat is the biggest logistic fair in Europe. Then we also have the IPOREC. That's a 3D rack configurator. You can choose a rack of the catalog from you can change the height, the width or something, and you can see directly your changes in 3D. So you can manage your own racks and see them also in 3D. Our manufacturers we have are our consumers. We have partner also, so it can be said, is ITEM, Industrietechnik, Bebatec and Trilogic. You can save there a lot of time by building your own racks. So we are going on with the right side, the software and hardware. We have the IPOI. Now on that side, we also only have scanners. And that's the first scanner we have. It's a a scanner who drives to your factory and scans everything. The data he receives, you can import to our epolog on the left side. And so you can have your factory you have in epolog, and you can plan and optimize it. You can also do a gap analysis between the current data you have on the PC on and also the actual data you have in the factory. Then we have EpoOrbit. It's smaller. We can scan there some objects till 50 centimeters, and after that we can also do it, import it to epolog, and a scan, or the time to scan an object is about 2 to 3 minutes. So you have no measurement, no CRD drawing. It's very quick. And here we have a special thing. It's the EPO phase. The difference between the other two is that we here can scan persons. It's more a fair gag, I have to say. The person is sitting on a chair, and two Kinect camera are scanning the person, and after that you can receive a 3D PDF, and also you get the data to print yourself on a 3D printer, so you have at least yourself on your table. So yeah, here we will start with the data model concept, and now I would give up to Dennis Effert.
Give him a short round, please. So, let's test.
It's okay? Can you hear me?
Great.
Okay, as Martin said, we have a huge amount of data in our programs and for our developments, and for now I'll focus on the IPO plans IPO log. This is our software to visualize fabrication data and assembly lines and all this stuff. Basically, okay, you have this MVC, whatever you will call it. This is everybody should know it. For our things, we use the model purely in C++. They are the basic models. The view controller we use also in C++, and there we have implemented some special models to use them on the view. Starting with the sort filter model, Q sort filter model, everybody knows it. But we have also implemented some other models for ourselves we need. Representation model, collection model, I'll come back to this later. Yes, and also our view controller also sets in the views different properties we need there. The view itself is, of course, written in QML. And there we have the possibility also to implement a model behavior. For example, which is the behavior to sort something, we can implement this in QML directly. Okay, great. So for the communication, of course, method signals here and vocables, and here we use property signal slots. It's like the presentation before us, so you have seen this. I will shorten this up. We use just one role. This is the object role. We do not use roles for specific data. We always give the object back to QML we need there. So the object itself we give back from the model has further properties and vocables we can call from the GUI. Yes, as written here. Of course, you have to innovate QAbstract List model for this. You have seen this before. When you want to know something detailed about this, I have an appendix of it, and we can show you this on our stand, but I'll shorten this up. So, detailed descriptions and attachments when you won't see them. Let's start with the sort filter model. The sort filter model has a source model is here. It's unsorted objects or instances in there, whatever is type T. And we want to sort them, and so we have, for example, ascending index order and say filter indices smaller than 4, and so this is the result we have for the GUI. The next model is in the representation model we use. In the representation model, you have a type T in your model, and you need type R in your GUI. So this is a problem. You need to build up a representation of this, and you have to master this, because you cannot handle this type T in your GUI, or you do not need it. You just need a specific representation there. And so we have also a source model. It's implemented familiar to the other model. And for example, use a type error to represent a single source instance. And so this is the result here. Whatever R is. Keep in mind that instances of R may already exist or be allocated by the representation model. So in your data model somewhere else in your program, you can have already this type error instances, but it is also possible that this representation models allocate the data for it. And of course it has to maintain the memory for it. You just need it for a specific view. And so you can also let the memory deallocation to the garbage collector and something like this, but I'll show you this later. Another idea of a representation model is you combine some source items as described here. Let's say you have a view and you need some representation from 3 and 4. Then you have a type S, whatever this is. Another model is a collection model. Let's assume you have two different models here from type T and U, and you just have to represent them in the GUI as one model. We will see an example for this later. So, for example, this is my restriction collect by a random criteria. Whatever this is, let's say from this model 1 and 2, and from this model everything from 1 to 4, but R3 and R4 are missing from the first model here. Okay, but keep in mind, T and U have to have the mutual superclass R. This is because our model has to have a class here. In addition, you can combine these models and building something like this. For example, here's two models. Use a collection model to build them up with one type, and then use a subfolder model and delegate this to the view. So as we have seen here, these types are sorted here, luckily, but they do not have the representation. This collection model is not able to sort them. So another model is able to do this. To give you an idea how this works in our software, I'll show you the software. This is IPOLOG, and I'll show you here.
So,
can you hear me?
Great.
So, this is an instance of IPOLOG here. And as you can see, and Martin mentioned before, we built up complex data in an industry. Industrial environment. And what you can see is here, this is a production line where later on a specific product is assembled and built. And here's a placed material. So we have a hierarchy here. We have some areas where these racks are placed here. And there are boxes in there. And as you can imagine, that there's a hierarchy of data on the back. This is not everything. It's just not that plain. We have a lot of information to build up this. We have information about our provision, the requirements, how to deliver this to this assembly line and something like this. There's a huge amount of data we have to handle here. I'll show you first this diagram here. This is QML. And as you can see, this is a top view of our scene. And we have here just the areas are shown here. And they all face to the safe model, of course. To represent these areas, we just need a list model and place within a QML and a repeater, place them at a specific location they have. Further, each area here has a model with its child components called here rex or boxes you can see on the floor. I'll show you this in a minute in the code. So, as you can see here, this is, it's complex. It's a complex code now because I don't go to implement something here. Just show you what we have done. And as you can see, we have here just a repeater. And this repeater shows us the all areas in selection, whatever this means. So just use a repeater, delegate a specific item, whatever you want to display here. This is quite simple. Okay, So this is the first thing. The other thing is we have this planogram here. So this planogram is able to display all selected areas and racks we have there and show them from the front. So the planner is able to rearrange the boxes and something like this. But there's another feature we also want to have when I select another rack, for example, here. So work. So we display this is in debugging mode, so sorry for that. But we have both racks, as you can see here. But we have the area on the right side, and we have selected the rack on the left side. But we want to display both in different tracks for the area, as you can see here. So this is the first problem. You need a specific model for this, because you have a selection, two different models for the selection, one for the areas and one for the racks. And you want to display it in the same in the QML. The next one is our worker Gantt. I'll show you this in the slides. Okay. So this is a view I haven't shown you, but also here you can see how you have to build up your GUI. You need to, for example, these are the activities a worker have to do on our assembly line. As you can see here, we have different products, and on our station, as you saw them in the GUI, they have to do different activities here. This is a time schedule of this for each product and each worker. Here, this is worker on the left side, and here's three products, and this is all the activities. This is in QML2. So you have to display this from the data model. And as you can see here, we have a worker here. There is a product line, and the product line is, of course, located in a model in a worker. The worker has a model with all its products. Further, the product line itself, or the product, has a model of activities located here, and so on, activity groups. This is the layout menu, layout editor I showed you, or material zone editor. Here you have the area, as I mentioned, contains all components in the simple list model, and you have a component on area. This is a QML file to represent a single component, and then the edit window itself. Also, you want to have the possibility to select multiple racks here, for example, or components, and then you need a sort filter model of selected components. In the rack, what you have seen, a rack planogram, what you've seen before with the rack planogram, we need to use a sort filter model here, because we want all this stuff in the correct X direction, and we want just the selected ones. This is the planogram area and so on. So these are the single QML file. You will see this later. Great. So let's schedule this back. Okay. So, okay. First of all, as I mentioned, I want to. Now this takes a while. Great. So I wanted to display in this view here everything I have selected, or everything that is located on an area I have selected. So I have selected the area. All right, I can display my area here, and it works. But when I go here and select this rack, I have a problem. There's nothing displayed there. Why? In the QML repeater listens to the selected areas and not the selected racks. Show you in code. You can see we have here a model. A workspace is just an instance, a context property we defined for the QML code. And say selection and then areas. This is a simple list model. But this does not work, as we see. We want also to have the single rack here in selection. So what we use here is an areas in selection. And this areas in selection is a sort filter model. Filters for all areas which are selected itself, or have an item on it or a component on it that is in the selection. Mainly it listens to the area model in the selection. But the filter or the
Yes, the filter implementation looks for the childs in the area and says, okay, there's a selected rec, so you come to the target model. When we use this, then you can see that the rec appears here, and we display the area here because there's something in selection on it. So you have a written collection model. This here is, a sort filter model we use here. The next one I wanted to mention is that we have an area object. So this is an XQML file representing a single area. The single area is here just such an area where everything is located. Of course, we can say we show all components on the area. So this is the repeater for the single rack or for the single components. You can see here 5 components on this area 4, for example. But so you get all racks, but you only want to have the racks that are selected. As an example on this area here. So what do you need? First of all, you do not need just the components because the occurrence in the model is, of course, not the occurrence in X direction. So you have to sorting. You have to sort them, the components. And further, you need to filter them whether they are selected or not. And when we do this, you can see this is now the correct ordering and it works. Okay, we dive deeper into the code. Now we want to display what's in the boxes. In the boxes, there is located material. And as you can see here, we print out here in this diagram just the name of the box located there. But you can imagine there can be more boxes with the same material in it, and we only want to see the material. So this is the next task we have to solve via models. I go in there and show you this here. So we can just say, okay, object, this is our rec, and we look to the shelf. The shelf itself is let me fix out something else. One level higher. As you can see here, we have shelf 1, 2, 4, and the list is in the wrong order. So we have one at the bottom. So what we need here is, of course, as you can guess, a filter model. So we do not need just the shelves, we need the shelves by height. And this is, of course, a filter model too. As we see now, they're in the correct order here. Yeah. This is simply a sorting by a set position in this case. The next thing I wanted to show, as I said, here we, with this repeater, we just show every name of the boxes there. And you can see 3 times the same box. But we want to have the material. And this is the next thing where you need a specific model. And this is implemented here. This model tries to find unique provisioning requirements. This is a synonym for material in our speech. So it shows you now for each shelf a single material, regardless whether this material is located in multiple boxes. Okay. Great. So to display this, we have here a complex data model. You don't have to fix out this in detail, but we have complex models can result in multiple boxes and X boxes like here. And we have to fix out which boxes contain which material to just show one material and not for each box located in the shelf. So some hints for you when you want to implement QML, complex GUIs. First of all, divide and conquer. Always try to separate your view hierarchy into separated files. It's much easier to reuse and structure them, because when you build up something like the planogram view we have seen in just one file, this was something about 4,000 or 5,000 lines of code. So you cannot handle this. Separate your QML files. Next is limit your file size. My experience is 300 to 500 lines of code per QML file is good. Next one, use property aliases to build up an interface for your QML files. Let's assume you have a QML file, and deeply in that you have a data you want to give to an upper level. Let's say, for example, some direct position or something like this. Just define them in the header of the QML file, and so you can use them from other locations. So divide and conquer, use property aliases, build your own library with QML elements. We have done this yet. For example, for the axis and the coordinate system you have seen, this also helps you. Then the second hint for you, keep the garbage collector in mind. This is a problem I showed you in a minute. The QML engine supports the JavaScript ownership and the CCPP ownership, as you know, but you have to keep in mind when you build a model just for a view and give it back to the view, and the view, the garbage collector says, okay, it's done, I do not need it anymore, I deallocate it, then your program, of course, will crash. Perhaps you are referred from every else. So the garbage collector may cause crashes. So always make clear which ownership do you want to have when you define your methods with Q invocables. Our experience is that when you give a reference back from a Q invocable method in your view controller, the ownership is automatically set to JavaScript. Yes, and this causes many of crashes in our programs. So do not let the engine free your space or control your program, this JavaScript engine. Okay, let me show you some more code here. As I mentioned, for example, the model to sort the racks in the rack planogram. You can see here, we use a specific model. For example, it's this model here. It's a simple sort filter proxy model. And this is for us to sort and filter out racks that are selected in the correct X direction, as I showed you. We have some conditions here. You can see is selected or something to say, okay, we show this rack or we don't show it. In addition, we have the sorting function here, just sort them in X direction, as you can see here. This is basically the idea behind that, to display all these racks here in the correct direction and correct sorting. The next model we have here is this representation model for the material. As you can see here, each material is displayed per line. And we use also a model here, this representation model. And this representation model has also a source model. And when the source model changes, count changes, it recalculates what to show in the view. As you can see here, we just need unique materials, and we use a list to fix out which materials you do not have already to give up a unique material list in the end. Okay. For the implementation of the shelves, as you have seen here, the shelves are in the correct order now from the Z direction. This is not the order in the model, of course. We just have a list here. We need another model, and this model is, of course, a sort filter proxy model, and you can find it here. And Yes. Filter accepts row. Of course, we want to show all chefs, so we just return true here. And this function returns your shelves by their height, for example. X axis, Y axis, and Z axis depends on what you have say to the model on the construction time. Okay. This is the idea behind that. And yes, putting all this together, you can build up such an GUI where you have a lot of data, as you can imagine now, put them together and display as you want. Yeah. Okay. For now, this is it. It is. Are there any questions for now? Yes.
How many items do you have involved?
Oh. And this depends on which product line we are referring to. We have product lines with about 2,000 materials. And this ends up in something about 500 or 600 boxes. But with Qt Quick 2, the performance has much increased, so this is no problem there. Are there any other questions? Yes. So the question was, when we use a lot of JavaScript, there's no compiler to check whether the syntax is correct. This is the question. Yes, yes, of course. We use an auto-reloader while we are programming. So you have seen this, the program. I haven't stopped the program, so the QML is directly reloaded, and we debugging by writing the code just in time. Because we can directly see the result, but you are right. You have to check this double to make sure that there are no great mistakes based on the data. Yes, please. Different types. So we have our data from a database, from Excel files, from JSON files, and yes, this data come from many different places. So this is the reason why we have such a huge amount of data, and now we have to put them together. Let me show you something else for this. Yes, this is a very, very simple representation of our central model. We have something called provisioning requirement. This tells us where to place and how much boxes. Then we have a delivery type tells us which boxes. And we have assembly requirement that tells us which material for which activity is needed with this box. So there's a very complex description of the assembly line. For example, you need X boxes to build this product and you have to place them in this specific rack. And so based on this, there is a very complex hierarchy. Okay. There was another question behind there. Yes. Basically, behind all this and on the base of the data, there's just a simple list model. So for each data type, we have racks, boxes, these three types here. We have, for each of them, we have list models. And now the challenge is to build new models that combine these models and build them up to the view. We just load them in and put them in the models with append. There's no magic about this. Indeed, it's time consuming because our first approaches, we do not unload QML or something. So all the QML stuff reacting on this model, and this is a huge chain of interaction. But when you cut off the QML for the loading process, it's quite fair. So for this line you have seen, we take something about 4 or 5 seconds to load them. And then we activate the QML afterwards. This is something I would recommend to everybody. And all the QML is reestablished again. Question here? This is a good question. Why we do not reuse role names? I'll show you. I recognize this question there behind, so I'll come back later. It's simply because when we use role names, we have to define role names for each in each model for each data we want to get. And so for this, we just return in each model, we just return a role named object role, and we just return a reference to the object. And the object itself has a lot of properties, Q properties. So we can directly refer to everything we want. You do not have to build new roles or something like this. So as you can see, for example, we are here in a repeater. Listen to the selected areas repeater. And the object, this one here, actually in this line, is our object. And this is the reference. So we can say object and say name. And console, or whatever you want to do. Yeah. Something like this. It's quite simple. So when we need another property from the object, we just say dot object, and then whatever we want to get there. I can show you this, for example, this is our Bane base model. No, this is wrong. Let's show the rec. So the rec has some properties here, for example, a type or which area it is on. And as you can see, here's also a pointer on the areas where these racks are on. And so we can just say area, point, whatever you want. This is much, much easier to use. Okay, question behind there? The question was about the file watcher. We call this file watcher, and this file watcher looks every 300 milliseconds, I guess, for the notification date of the QML file. This is just in debugging. And we unload the complete QML file. I can show you this in a minute. Yeah. And yeah, we just have two methods here, and these methods are called by these autoloader. This is a simple timer looking for modification in the file. So when I edit a file in the Qt Creator and say okay, save, then my application directly loads the QML new, and we just unload it. The new QML file. Yes, it's just for debugging issues. So we are much faster while you do debugging. Not the single components.
But you're not
only
loading single components within your
No. I think this would be too complex. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So I hope you have understand at least something. The title was Complex GUIs, and so I focused on our complex GUIs. We are also hiring. If you are interested in Qt QML and something like this all this stuff I showed you, all this black magic, and when you are match this profile, you can visit our stand. We have here, we have also Oculus Rift there, and we have implemented Hyperlock to the Oculus Rift, and you can see scenes. Built up with PQML with the Oculus Rift and the 3D scene, of course, I've showed you. Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much.